Happy Tuesday, everybody. Do you know what we're listening to?
No.
Who did they go by? Rev. This is somebody on YouTube who has taken, you know, the decade of SpongeBob SquarePants clips from you know, Nickelodeon.
Yeah.
And run it through the Vocaloid process. And so she, I believe it's a she, has basically made a SpongeBob Vocaloid that can sing. So if you listen to the voice of this, this is
Tom Kenny as SpongeBob.
And the Japanese, and some of the Japanese SpongeBob voice actor also.
Got it.
Listen to him.
Wow.
Yeah.
So this is, okay, so this artist, wow.
So this is like a cover of another Vocaloid song, but that's what this is.
That is amazing.
Vocaloids.
Oh, so Vocaloid is like the that virtual singer thing where you can actually, it's a voice that you can make sing.
Oh,
but it's all digital.
Cool. Yeah. Bobcats. I do recall that cartoon. That's what I thought he was referencing.
What, Bobcat?
Yeah,
wait,
yeah,
what?
I love the Vocaloid's great 70s cartoon. Yeah,
oh. is that the one that had Shmoo?
Yeah.
What were those called?
It was Shmoo and then Orko and then what's the snarf guy? It was all the sidekicks.
Yeah, that's right. Shmoo, Orko, and Snarf. Yeah.
It was all the sidekicks.
Lion-O! That's great.
Mike, are you playing guitar today?
I don't know.
I don't know either.
I always figured I did. So yeah. In fact, I learned. Thank you.
Go on.
Do you want me to turn the mics off?
Yeah.
Let's do that. Let's do that.
That'll be good. Yeah. Okay. Maybe.
Oh
maybe.
No. We what? Both did the thing.
What thing did we do?
Oh, you both are... did things out of order?
Yeah.
So you're both sending each other?
although, hold on. Pow.
I can almost make a fish.
Oh, shit. Oh, yeah. No, oh, it's man, still not working just, on Skype. Yeah.
You got to call back. You got to call back.
That bad. That's
I
so
yeah.
crazy.
No. Well, so what happened was... we'll talk about it, sure. But,
do we have to...
Huh?
Didn't you... has it been a week since...
It's
been 72 hours.
I'm beginning to suspect that this is actually like one of those like, I kind of you've got like a deep seated
oh,
need want to
chop
hurt yourself.
Off. Yeah. Like, no, I want to be that, the that, wizard like, yeah. with no hands. Yeah. That seems really rad.
That is, but you know what? The thing is when you pull off a trick with no fingers.
There's video up. They fooled Penn and Teller. They got fooled by sleight of hand by a dude without hands. It was pretty amazing.
That's crazy. Right on. Well, all right. Well, yeah, that's some skill. That's some crazy skill.
Yeah. And the guy was super cool.
All right. You should be able to see us.
Oh, wait, hold on. Wait a minute. I think I fucked it up. Here we go.
Your patron Saint John Cena is looking over you.
Oh, bravado!
Hey.
Oh! You're gonna have to do some cropping here because my
cropping and locking.
This is not my black mat. This is not my DSLR.
That's right. Your C910, 920.
It's my C910 because the DSLRs went fucking kaputsky for the last 2 days.
Oh no!
Weird. Okay.
But
yeah,
in an effort to try to figure it out, I wound up downloading Wirecast 7.
Yeah,
and it's interesting.
Oh no, please don't tell me it's interesting.
That's always what you want to hear about the fundamental architecture of your show.
I mean, like, I don't know. At this point, like, I'm trying to, like, I'm in that point where it's like it's tech, so you're either Zen. Or you're gonna literally slit not only your throat, but you're gonna slit other people's throats after you've slit your throat,
dude,
which is always
dude.
Fun.
That is without a doubt my favorite advancement we've made in our going on 10-year relationship is the advancement from throat slitting to Zen. Like the fact that we've realized that, you know, nobody is going to care that you're using a webcam instead of a DSLR as long as you're funny.
Yeah, I mean, it's, oh, this is how you do that. That's actually an interesting
It's just
solution.
Really hard to be funny on a webcam. Yeah.
Or just, although the cool thing I like about this is that Wirecast 7 gives you more control and access to your webcam settings from inside the app.
Oh, that's cool.
Oh,
that's
so it's like when you go to it as a thing, here's a fun tech chat for everybody. When you go to your device, you can fuck with your own focus and brightness and everything right inside Wirecast 7.
Oh, cool. I've been looking at Andrew Zarian moved over to vMix, and I've seen some other people move to that. And I'm
Andrew Zarian was talking up vMix pretty loud.
The other thing, but looking over vMix, I'm not totally sold on how it works with Skype stuff, so we'll see.
I mean, that's the biggest thing is like we have a like. Sorry, it's kind of like this scar. like you can, you can.
Just need to keep bringing
it's like fire eating.
If you can do that,
but, no. My point is that long term you can have a more efficient thing, but you have to go through the trauma of starting all over again and having a surgeon scrub the scar or whatever.
Yeah.
And then in which case you're back to stitches again, whatever.
Isn't that a really weird thing that you're into like scar metaphors now? Like, now
I mean, it's not like I spend all day every day looking at. Massaging 1, 2, 3, now 4.
That's cool. I don't think that's think that's a collection that actually builds in value over time.
Hey, Brian and Justin, did the friends who are part of the bit today get told that they're part of the bit today?
On my side it did.
Mine's okay. Right here.
I brought mine.
All right. Just
if I brought mine, I mean I can find it around here somewhere.
Oh.
She can't run that fast.
Great. Well, it's great. Yeah. Oh, right. It's in the dock.
So, have you guys... I don't think... last week, did... You did. So there's still flaming. Flaming shots are still. They must be. They must be their last night, right?
We were talking about winding that bit down last week, but we could definitely do a hurrah if we have some accumulated.
Well, that
especially
was,
if there's a rad ass song.
I think it ended with us hoping that there would be one last Summer Lovin' under the docks. But there wasn't, then. Was God's way of telling us to stop mocking people for lighting themselves on fire.
Shit, son! Look at this.
We did get some. I asked people to push in and see ones that we haven't found. Hopefully, these are all new ones. But we'll get to those in a bit. We'll watch a few videos first. I do want to see what Alex Jones uncovers Picklegate is, though. If
here it is.
Oh, that's not how you open a can of pickles.
Can?
There's no pop when she opens it. Pop. You pop them open. You pop them open. You pop them, pop, 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 pop them. You don't turn them like it's peanut butter or jelly or something. Can we zoom in on this? You have to pop it, ladies and gentlemen. You have to pop it. Pop. It's popped. It's vacuum sealed. It's vacuum sealed. Pop, pop. You open it by pressuring down and popping. Look at that. I can't even want to get it open. My hands are wet.
Yeah,
I can't even open this. This is real. This is really happening. I can't even open this. Worked up a sweat there. I couldn't open it.
You gotta hit it on the side of the thing. Get it warm. You gotta touch it down there.
I definitely said eat shit to a fan last night talking about emails.
Oh, dude, yeah, you got all fired up about emails.
Well, I had what I thought
Who
was really.
Who are you, Breitbart News? Fired up about emails?
I had what I thought was a really clever idea. Like, part of the reason I am perpetually at inbox zero on Twitter. I respond to every single person, right? Yeah, okay. And the reason is because there's the artificial constraint of it being 140 characters. They can't take too much of my time saying things, and I can't take too long to write that stuff.
Yeah.
It's very easy. It's very manageable. But email's another thing. So because somebody could care so deeply that they write, 12 paragraphs, and I open it and I get as far as like, ooh, this looks important. Let me answer that when I have a proper amount of time, is like, future never, right? And so I was thinking, like there should be an opt-in program where it's like I'm doing the 1 hour inbox, and once you're in the program, just every day at midnight, it just takes anything left in there that didn't get gotten to, and it deletes them. Full on deletes them, destroys them, and emails everyone who wrote you, said, hey, Brian is doing 1 hour inbox. He did an hour. He didn't get to yours. Might have been that he didn't see it. Might have been he had a real emergency, but he definitely didn't read it. It definitely got destroyed.
And if you
would you like to A, send it again, or B, write a shorter version? Or rewrite it in a different way.
Or reach out on Twitter.
Exactly. And then, oh my God, like that is something I could publicly step into and say, I'm sorry, I'm 1 hour inboxing. There's nothing I could do. I've become Amish. It's my new religion. And then a bunch of people are like, well, why don't you just prioritize your email? Have you read Getting Things Done? Have you, this? And then there was one person who was like, I don't like this. It's saying that your time is more valuable than your fans' time. And so I responded, eat shit.
First of all,
I quoted him.
Yeah, also you quoted
him. And I responded, eat shit. I'm doing 4 hours of email a day and still falling behind.
And that's the
there are a lot of quotes there.
I took everybody and gave them the mic and put them on the public stage.
Here's my only question about your email thing. Because, by the way, I'm all for anybody who tries to make email better. I think everybody should be rewarding that. But do you think that will make you get less emails? Like, I feel like you are going to wind up getting more emails because you're going to be asking right now. Your emails, as massive as that avalanche is inert. They've sent an email. They are awaiting a reply. If you are actively every night telling everybody that hasn't read your email, yes, you are deleting them. But you are asking them to resend the email, or even automating, hey, would you like to press this button to resend the email?
Why don't you gate it by money? So if they pay you $5.
First of all, Bill Gates. Bill Gates actually proposed this as a way to eliminate spam. Is essentially say like you have to pay like literally just one penny an email. If you charged one penny an email, that would not affect personal correspondance in any meaningful way.
Well, it would absolutely shut down spam.
Yeah.
Well, you could do that with Facebook. You were able to like pay a dollar to send a message to somebody you are not friends with or something like that.
You know what would be great?
That was a thing that Facebook
is a
that's a real fun idea until headline Facebook for $5 let my abusive ex-husband threaten to kill me.
Well, that's probably why you don't hear about it so much.
What was the question?
My question was, does your system get you more or less emails? Because there is a world in which, because obviously we can't prove it, but it's like there's a world in which I could imagine you wind up getting not only more emails, but more urgent or perturbed emails than you get now.
I'll tell you what. My guess is that it will actually result in less, because if anything has shown me anything, is that people are really bad at remembering to opt in at anything. There's a reason. A reason you lose 90% of people trying to sign up for your newsletter for every opt in layer that you add, right? Mm-hmm. And my guess is people will try once, try it twice, or whatever, and then forget and then give up. But even if I'm totally wrong, and let's say everybody, 100% of them, let's say the email increases tenfold. Then that's fine.
You're only gonna get to an hour.
I'm still just gonna do an hour a day.
So yeah,
guilt
yeah,
free. Yeah, yeah. Guilt free. An hour a day.
It's funny because I definitely feel that same compulsion. Like anybody that emails me, I think they deserve to reply, right? The thing is, but you do get a point where it's like, what do you do? I've got 150 emails, and the thing is, like, yeah. So I definitely do understand that, and so yeah, I think that I think what you do is you just make it a lottery. You give them all a
no. Yeah, like, I mean to be honest,
that steps ain't bad. Of complexity.
But again, so here's the thing: is people what email does very, very poorly is it. All the email soldiers show up in a line as if they're all equally important.
Yeah.
And there's no way for the reader to know how they all act urgent and they all act important. Most of them are not urgent. Most of them are not important. This would be a method of self-selection where, like, for example, a producer at a television show is trying to book me, gets that email saying, sorry, Brian does an hour a day and you didn't make the list. Here are some alternate ways to reach him. You could click this button and send again. That guy's going to click the button because he's got somebody who says, I need an act, and it could be this guy. Whereas the kid who has... you know, is vaguely like who says, hey, can you give me a shout out on YouTube? That kid maybe clicks send again 2 days, 3 days, and then he gives
This is the issue, though. And this is where I think there was a disconnect between you and some of the people in your ads last night.
Yeah.
Because you have a very specific email problem. You have not only a great volume of it, but because of the nature of magic in general and YouTube specifically, you're in the Venn diagram of I need to write this person 9,000 words for two different reasons. A, young people who are enamored with your stuff, very flattering, but that means they have endless time to do stuff. And it's magic, which means there's just going to be a billion different, like, even for the young enthusiast, there's going to be a lot of that.
There's a third layer to it, which is that there is a significant chance that some true gold is in there when I do get around to seeing it. Oftentimes, the best emails that end up being scam school episodes and stuff. And by the way, Gavra in the chat says, you're totally wrong, Brian. The kids would resend, but the producer would not. 10 fucking years of experience speaks to the contrary, sir. How about that?
Gosh, Jesus Christ!
I'm saying, factually.
There might be a tone issue in some of the communication.
Eat shit. Sorry. Maybe that was a. I'll dial that back.
But that's the thing is, and it is sad because the thing. Well, it's funny because for me, like. That's the thing that gets me through whenever things feel really bleak, you know, like I go to my emails and, oh, there's some person in Lithuania that just discovered the band and we helped them through, like, oh, and I love it, you know, and that's awesome. But the thing is that I just don't have the time to, you eventually get to the point where you're like, I can't, what do I do guys? You know, like, and so I think that I'm going to hire monkeys.
I almost hired like a virtual assistant then something felt a little bit odd about roping in a stranger over Skype to literally all of my financial personal correspondences.
Well, also their job would be to read your emails and then email you your emails on some abstract level.
Which is, again, why I'm hoping it seems like there should be an algorithm that can say, look, Brian has three responses. Whenever it's a scam school episode that's been done before, he says his polite way of saying, all right, let's just take scam school episodes. Sometimes they're clever. Sometimes we've done them before. And sometimes they're garbage. If they're garbage, I respond, classic. This one's a classic.
They sent you a thing, right?
Yeah,
they've sent you a trick, they sent you a video, and it's some like thing that you've seen a million times, or it's stupid.
Yes,
the girl
yes.
climbed into a box, you take her saw, you cut her in half, look at
this one's a classic. Which is why it's not on Scam School. If it's been on, you know, then it's like, yeah, we did this one a few years back. Thanks for thinking of me. And then that's the vast majority. But then like 10% of them are like, holy fuck, This is great.
Yeah, yeah, cool.
This is great.
People,
and you're
people,
great.
Are, people are in the chat room mentioning, oh, wow, I got a classic response.
Sorry, Bad Weave. Just peel it. Just goat see in a little of the curtain here.
Hey, I got an idea for you.
What's that?
Because how much of this would you say is scam school related emails?
I'll say a third. Third scam a third. School, a third scam stuff, and a third life advice or career opportunities or whatever.
If there was a way for you to have just the scam school stuff sorted, would that markedly make your email life better?
Oh, my God. Yes, because I would say of the because here's the problem. If the email starts off, I have an idea for a scam school episode, and then I see paragraph, paragraph, paragraph. I think not now, because I'm not shooting scam school right now. Yeah. And so, like, if somebody were to just go and be able to gauge, like, this has been done before, it's garbage, or it maybe belongs in the idea bin, because then all I do is I copy and paste it, I put it in the idea bin on Google Docs, and then I say, hey, thanks, it's in the idea bin. And then if and when I use it, because again, every time we do scam school, I go and I check the idea bin, and I'm like, oh yeah, that would be a fun thing to do.
What if you did this?
What if a separate email account for scam school ideas?
Well, number one, it would involve at least some version of email filtering, and I don't know whether or not you can do that on your end, or you just start on new scam school episodes. Now it's scam school at scam school dot scam school, right? But what if it was now like a job for Penny or someone that you trusted, that you could just say, hey, put the emails in the bins and send, you know, and then you can at least easily have that sorted.
It's not bad. Not child labor. At all.
Child labor.
That's efficient. That would make it a family business.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah.
Which would qualify us for a federal exemption under.
Tell you what, show her the ropes. This is what daddy does for a living. Talks to people 2 years older than you. Now here you can get a full.
By the way, wait a minute!
I think this is exactly what happened. I think this is exactly how Ivanka Trump got involved with the Trump organization. I think she was actually responding not to his
answering her dad's emails.
Yeah.
Hey, real quick, because we're not nearly as successful as a multinational conglomerate, Comcast, NBC. Can we talk shit about NBC this week about Saturday Night Live? Like, I watched all of the new.
Oh, let's talk shit. New segment called Talking Shit. Hey, fuck you, you fucking dick. We talking shit. Talking shit. Talking shit. Fuck you. All right. Here we go. That's it.
Saturday Night Live has always, you know, figured out a really good sketch and done like 18 million versions of the same sketch, right? But this was the first week that I was like, that was the exact same sketch, and it wasn't funny this time.
That's what they do, right?
Of course. And I don't know if like I'm just old enough that I don't fall for it anymore, or if genuinely the joke wore off, because like the People's Court Trump bit, tons of potential, and instead it was just, you know, hey, I'm Trump, I'm People's Court. Here's the same bits you've seen before.
Problem is this. And this is why I think I forget if I actually tweeted this or not, but like we're in the juiced ball era for political comedy. Like, because Trump is kind of a character, we're just going to get a lot more people laughing at political jokes than there are funny political jokes because of the nature of how caricaturable Trump is. So the problem now is what you want to separate is like, okay, if I had no vested political interest in this, is this joke funny? And that's the problem that I think Saturday Night Live fell in this week. It was like, all right, setup, funny setup. I'm Trump, I'm doing Trump things, meh, 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 right? Punchline, well, I'm serious. And this is a fact.
Yeah, yes. That now, well, and
then cut to Trump. I'm a moron, I'm Trump. And everyone's like, ah, what a character. But really, there was no punchline. It was just like, well, we're federal judges. Like the federal judges didn't have a parrot or, you know, like, you know, wasn't speaking in carny talk or anything. Didn't have a trick elbow. Like, it was just like, I'm a judge. And you're like, cool, I guess they're judges. Look at it. They're all normal and he's a kookaburra.
Well, and the Spicer thing the first week I found absolutely hilarious. But I was really hoping for literally one new joke. And there wasn't. It was literally all the same jokes. Literally.
So the other problem is that, and this is kind of a thing with SNL, is that there tends to be this hanging dread that if they make characters that they politically disagree with too likable, that they are in fact making the world fall in love with the real person. Like, read interviews with Adam McKay and Will Ferrell, and they're like, yeah, we did a great George W. Bush, but we made him too funny and we made him too likable, and we genuinely
feel bad for having done that, and
we feel terrible that we made him too funny and too likable and too relatable, and we're the reason why he got into office two terms. We thought we were using our powers for good and we were using our powers for bad. Because the problem with the Spicer thing,
that's a lot of hubris, but yeah.
The problem with the Spicer thing is that the next level of that joke is to feel bad for him, because he's obviously this character that's in this crazy hectic trauma. And the funniest thing that you can do is reveal vulnerability from absolute aggression.
Right.
But they won't, and they can't. They're just going to keep finding new ways for him to spit acid and drop nets and everything. And at that point, it's Roadrunner and Wile E. Coyote, where it's just like, what's the new way we can have the person fall down?
I guess, and they've done stuff like this before, but I was hoping for a surprise. Like, the Spicer thing starts off exactly like last week, and maybe 2 minutes in, it stops, and a spotlight shines on Spicer, and he starts singing Send in the Clowns. Super, you know, like, I don't know.
There's a million, and it seemed like
what they were going to do, because it started off with where he's like, I'm gonna be calm this time, you know, and then he's like straight back at the, you know. So you're like, okay, but you're right. Then it kind of stayed on that same note, same
rails.
Yeah. Alas.
Although this is also coming from the guy who figured out an excuse to do Mr. Happy Pants three times in three Universal Orlando shows. So I mean, it's like, look, I understand. There's producing a show week after week. You only have so much bandwidth to work with. So I'm certainly not blaming. I'm just
although I do think, like, what was the percentage on Trump sketches during that episode? Like, it had to be like 70% were all politically or Trump directly related, right? Like, they were, it was almost like every other sketch had some kind of political bent, which on one level, like, you can't blame them, because politics are hot right now. That's all anybody wants to fucking talk about.
Boy, man, if my Twitter feed is any indication, it's the weirdest thing. It's like overnight, the purpose of Twitter transformed. Like, I thought it was a place where we all talked about anything. Turns out it's now a place where we all talk about exactly one thing.
I tell you what, I just realized I hadn't posted any pictures of my kids on Facebook since the election.
Really?
It's nice. Like I used to do all these lighthearted, like, oh, and look at them being silly now. And then now I'm just like, yeah, what petition do I need to sign? Yeah, that woman thing.
I know. Well, and also, listen, there is a weird, like, the wolves are out, man. Like, if you post a picture of, like, you know, Josie riding a bike in slow motion, like, the first comment's going to be like, stop normalizing Trump. You're giving him exactly what he wants.
Stop acting like everything's fine.
Everything's not fine.
Nothing is fine.
ACLU. Hashtag Planned Parenthood.
Yeah, that's in fact, I have very conservative family members, and I have people in my immediate family who the Fox goes on at 6 a.m. and stays on all day long, and that's just their perspective. And so I was trying via Facebook to engage both sides of my, like, my entire family by saying, like, hey, you know, can I get my conservative friends to maybe offer me a perspective on this, you know, thinking that it would get some dialogue going. And man, did all of my hardcore liberal friends just come down on me for how dare you? Like, and I was like, this is.
How dare you befriend them?
Yeah, no.
They're less than human.
How do you even look at Trump and not like blah blah blah? And I'm like, hey guys, look, I can agree with your perspective 100%, but I'm just trying to like recognize that there's still another 50% of my family, the rest of the country, 50% of my family believe this. So like, we can't shut them out completely. We can't anyway. So
yeah,
it was ridiculous. Well, yeah, it's exactly what he wants you to think.
Yeah. Yeah.
Stop normalizing.
Yeah. That's. I was like, okay.
The thing that I think is hilarious is everybody has stopped using his name because somehow it got misconstrued as being popular because his name got dropped a lot.
Voldemort.
Yeah. So there's the whole Voldemort thing, you know? Like, yeah. And everybody's just like, this is weird. Why are we doing this? I don't know.
Hey, Justin. I don't know if Bonnie was extra.
I'm gonna goose it.
There you go.
Ash and I were on a panel, like a quiz panel, a couple weeks ago, and it was like you could not say President or Trump, and specifically those two together, without like the audience was just yelling. It was like you were searing them with a branding iron. You're like President Trump, yeah! It was like this, oh no! And it's like. I was like, man, he's not Voldemort. And by the way, it didn't work for Voldemort.
He still came back.
The whole point was you should say his name so you can understand who he is and stop the Death Eaters.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. That's amazing.
Fear what you don't understand, you
know. Hey man, can we watch some at the misery of other people?
Can we do this back? Bryce tried to get flaming shots going.
Yeah, sorry.
No, it's fine. It's fine. We're just getting loose. The warm-up laps. Y'all, it's time for
the last time.
It's time for
the last time. Flame shots.
Stop acting like everything's normal.
Stop acting like everything's normal. It's flaming shots. Them shots on fire. Your face is burning. Everyone, lesson you're learning, it's don't do shots on fire. That's really bad. I'm not a liar. Eat shit, y'all. I don't like email.
Eat shit, y'all. Eat shit, y'all. Eat shit, y'all.
All right. Take us away.
Do you guys want to just re-explain the bit one last time?
Man, for old time's sakes, I'm sure it'll be back. I'm sure it'll be back.
I imagine
swang song.
We will find new fails.
Justin, walk us through
Let's go. All right, ladies and gentlemen, the Flaming Shot Challenge is when we play the first few seconds of a Flaming Shot fail video. At that point, Brian and all of our guests try to decide whether or not this is going to be one of several options, a very specific type of fail. Will indeed it be a Bluebeard, the classic, meaning that flames are dripping from the bottom of their face? Will it be a Dhalsim, a more evolved version, wherein the flames explode from the mouth? Is it a Ghost Rider? Will flames engulf the head? Is it a Johnny Storm where a body part is lit aflame? Is it a what was the feet getting lit on fire?
The Roadrunner?
The Roadrunner. Is it the Roadrunner? Is it a Note 7 where a cell phone adjacent gets lit aflame? Or is it the illustrious Is it a Mrs. Doubtfire wherein the breasts are lit aflame and they start getting fatted down, or somebody throws a piece of fruit at Pierce Brosnan? And
both
of course,
valid.
Finally, the rare, the never before seen, and dare I say, since this is the last time we're ever going to do it, we will never see a Knight Rider where somebody is lit on fire, walks into their car, and drives away.
All right, so we've got a flaming shot here. This is Flaming Shots Gone Bad. This is from Triceratops, which is misspelled. There has 1,281 views, 2 thumbs up, 0 thumbs down. We're going to watch just a couple of seconds of this.
This is a collection, it looks like.
This is not.
Oh, okay.
It's 30 seconds. It couldn't possibly be.
Oh, no. Just, yeah, Flaming Shots Gone Bad. Oh, my God, Brian, it's a double barrel.
Okay.
Two shots. This is like a.
This is a shoddy shot. Shotgun shoddy.
Are those
double barrel shotgun shoddy?
Those are beer cans. Okay.
I am smelling
a lot of. They're doing it right next to one of those passive
like
air freshener
thing. Air freshener.
Oh, geez.
Yeah.
That makes okay. That means it had to have been in 1990 or something, right? 1999.
No, they still have those.
They do.
Yeah. They're brown. Yeah. In many ways, the big boy never left.
Okay. White people, fluorescent lights.
White cabinets.
Why? I'm gonna say there's a cavalierness that I'm smelling early on. I'm gonna say body burn. I'm gonna go Johnny Storm.
All right, Brian says Johnny Storm. Justin,
double Johnny Storms.
A double, okay.
Double Johnny Storms. Wow. I'm going to go double Dalsim.
Double Dalsim.
Wow, that would be extraordinary.
Mm-hmm. I know,
Mike. What do you think is going to happen to these gentlemen?
I'm going to say the shot on the left is going to be a Bluebeard, but the shot on the right is going to be a Doubtfire.
Mm. Wow.
Wow.
Bonnie?
I say one guy has a success and the other is a Doubtfire. I feel like they're
okay,
all trying
Bonnie.
To look manly.
Bonnie, you know the like only the success is where they blow it out before they put it in their mouth. Sorry.
Yes, let me exactly. This is literally the Kobayashi Maru. The only way to win is to not play.
Yeah. You really think we're going to see one of them blow it out?
I think we've had that happen before on multis, though.
Yeah.
Where someone was
like
really
one
smart
person
and
knows how
blew
to
it
do
out,
it.
And the
okay.
Like,
all right.
Like,
the other
it's
one's
not
like,
unprecedented.
Oh my God.
Yeah. All right. All right. Here it is. So I've lit. What do you think that is? Maybe
that is a light blue, and it lit immediately, which tells me it has a flash point of over 80 degrees. So I'm going to say these are high proof. I don't know if it's ever clear or 151, but it feels upwards of that.
Okay.
Are they wearing synthetic blend? No, those look cotton.
Okay.
And he's
also,
smoking
oh
a
God,
cigarette.
God,
cigarette. He's the one that eats it.
It could be a neo noir. It could light a cigarette.
Plus, also, you guys. Oh, stop. Okay, look. Here's the thing.
It's filled to the top. These
it's
huge
filled
ass
to the top,
glasses.
And he's already waited 7 seconds.
So yes, yeah, so it's been
which
it's
means
been cooking,
the
yeah.
glass
yeah.
is fire hot now. 7 seconds is how long it takes. That glass is fire hot.
Sure. Yeah.
Oh, God, it's so hot. Right, oh, Jesus.
Oh, okay. They clinked the glasses.
Wait, hold on, wait. Is it on their shoes? Is it on the Roadrunner?
Well, let's see. Let's watch it all. No, it's not on the shoes.
Oh, he's got a hand.
Oh, fuck.
There's a Dalsim. There's a Dalsim.
Oh, we have fire.
I cannot believe.
We have a fire on the cabinet.
They melted holes in the carpet.
Yeah, I know.
The apartment is literally on fire.
Stop. And
okay,
he's
okay.
Fanning
okay.
All right,
I swear to God.
Wait.
I swear to God.
Shirtless guy in the back.
God damn it.
Keep it in your pants, Neshcon.
There's always one.
Was the shirtless guy the guy that actually was? Did he run around? Was that the
no.
guy that did take off his shirt?
No.
Was it a Mrs. Dalsim?
Okay. Real quick, can we do a little
Dalsim?
PSA here? Number one, we were all wrong. It was a carry slash fire starter.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Number two. Can just promise me, all of you, every time I see this stuff, people are under the idiotic impression that swatting a fire will ever put it out. It will never, ever, ever put out a fire.
You know what? But that's only because it hasn't been done yet. And the thing is, and if you keep trying, at some point in time, someone will do it.
You motherfucker.
What's our name for when someone's hand catches on fire? Because we've got a double of that.
That's a Johnny Storm, I guess? Oh, no, that's a Hadouken.
Hadouken, right?
We have double Hadouken here. The guy in the background, who is not even part of this.
Oh, did he get
got
fire?
His hand caught on fire here.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, it's the shirtless guy, I think.
Shirtless guy
see,
gets
you can see
on
briefly
fire.
The guy.
Wow.
He's got
never
even
too, made it to their lips,
he's like,
right?
Yeah, that's, he's
yeah
like,
they didn't even drink it.
Is that why he ran away?
Oh my gosh.
That's literally.
All right, come on, let's keep going.
Fire.
We only got one more night with these.
All right.
Okay.
All right. Yeah. All right. Let's get another flaming shot fail. Do. Is this a new one? All right, this is Flaming Sambuca Gone Wrong. This is from Rizzlerix.
I'm going to call it right now. This one's a fire starter. It goes all over the table.
Put it on the table?
Yep.
All right.
I'm going to say
they
this
put it
is
on the glass.
A Bluebeard.
Mike?
I mean,
y'all don't even want to watch. We can watch a bit of this first.
I say
no, it's only 15 seconds,
gonna,
man.
I'm
we gotta call
go,
it.
I'm gonna say.
Go ahead.
I'm saying note 7. I see the phone back there.
Oh.
Okay.
I'm gonna go with Knight. No, I'm gonna go with Ghost Rider. I'm gonna go with one of the writers.
Oh, Jesus.
I'll go with Ghost.
I mean, what do you? That is that a lady him?
That is.
This is like a fancy restaurant. There's like a like an appetizer plate and like a tablecloth.
Yeah, no apps are on the table.
Yeah. It turns out that same shirtless guy's running in the background.
Going out, go.
I'm a recurring threat, bro.
Bang.
Oh, Jesus. Straight up Bluebeard. Straight up Bluebeard.
Did he get on the phone?
No, I don't think
that. That's Bluebeard, possible fire crotch. A possible fire crotch.
Yeah. So that's Justin. Justin, you got that one. I got that one right.
That's.
Wait,
just,
what is it called?
Just, how could you not? I mean, I don't understand how you could look at. If you've spent any time, I could see 7-year-old children doing this and I'd be like, oh my God, again. But as an adult, like you would think that you've spent enough time with fire.
No,
like,
no, yeah. That's just it.
That's
most
so
people
crazy.
Don't. Most people
that's
do not.
That's so crazy.
Yeah. Also,
oh, dear God.
Also, very before hot. The age of like 22, guys are still developing the
brain chemistry.
Oh, it's not going to
happen.
We've
got Flaming Shots got wrong. This is from Taylor M9989. No subscribers, 838 views. 9 thumbs up, no thumbs down. This is April 2013.
I think that guy already had hair.
This looks
hair
like
on
a comedy
fire.
Sketch theme.
This is
around
a comedy thing.
Something.
Yeah, it's because he's older.
Oh, it does look like
it looks like a vine or something. Oh, it's 6 seconds long. It's a vine. I'm going to say no action. Fake.
Yeah.
Well, but it's still going to happen.
No.
Bluebeard.
Okay. Mike.
This is
I'm
a
gonna,
comedy
I'm
skit
gonna,
about.
I'm going to go with Ghost Rider again.
Okay.
This is a comedy skit about
Bonnie.
Because
he's got two.
Oh, gosh, I think Brian's right, but it's only because of that guy's hair. Like, I'm thinking...
He's got sketch comedians
hair. Yeah, he's got sketch comedian hair. I can't get past
you've
you.
You've got the hair of a sketch comedian.
Accurate.
That sounds like a Billy Joel line. Like, he had the hair of a sketch comedian. And a smirk like an old pirate's foot.
He thought he could eat some fire, but it turned out he went kaput.
He was a chimney with soot. Flaming shots. I'm singing the same melody
as the other
song.
This,
it's not a joke.
Is this Neil Diamond that we're doing?
No. Yeah.
All right, here we go.
I'm going to die.
He's like, oh, that's really hot. Go again.
Oh, shit!
It was,
that
coming? Wow.
Yes!
It was not a sketch.
That was a leap to the face.
That was a total
He pre-soaked his chin on
like
the one that,
that
he blew
like
out.
A pyro.
And then lit the other.
The X-Men pyro guy where the fire like flew out. Like.
That's a blue beard. That's Justin.
By the way, that is called Brian's fire eating routine. When you pre-soak with one torch and light with the other.
Oh, wow.
That was when fire eating came back to the theaters, right? And it was not about how hot you could make it, but the artistic license.
Holy shit, man. Yeah. Wow, that's good. Oh, boy, and double points to Justin for knowing the exact part of the routine I was thinking of.
Seen it a couple times. I've seen
just
your show.
Go for it.
All right.
Bushwood, Bluebeard.
We have Flaming Shot. Andrew Hu on YouTube, 9 subscribers, 1,421 views, 7 thumbs up. This is from 2006.
Wow. This one is, I mean, number one, this is the best viral marketing for Mr. Robot Season 3.
What?
Does he look like
that
Mr.
looks like
Robot?
A white Rami Malek.
Lee does. Well, I mean, come on, exposure. Like, on the camera. You never know.
Yeah.
All right, we'll start with Brian, this one's it happens very quickly, so I can't show you any more than this frame.
Fire crotch. Straight up fire crotch.
All right.
I say it is the Mrs. Doubtfire.
Looking at the muscle shirt. Mike, what do you think?
I'll do Firestarter.
Firestarter.
I'm gonna say Bluebeard because his face is all smooth and
you just want to caress
like...
it and make love to it.
And it's all just gonna be
it's Valentine's
fire.
Day, Bonnie, of all the days to
go ahead. No, you continue, Ryan.
Is something matter, Ryan?
No.
Something bothering
you? All right, here we go.
Yeah, why don't you ask Greg?
I don't know who Greg is, but Andrew, he was about to... Over his chin! Smooth chin!
That was a fire... I think...
And then his buddy started beating him up!
I think... Guys, I think you're all right. Hold on. Look at this. So he takes it immediately. Gets it on the mouth. That's a blue beard. Gets it on his muscle shirt. That's his Mrs. Doubtfire. He's going to have to pop that out. Gets it
in
on his
crotch. Definite crotch. That's crotch.
And then it's on the floor.
And then there's the fire starters. There's
it's on the floor. It's on the floor. Look under the chair.
Yep.
Oh, my God.
Boom. Boom.
Hey, out, everybody.
Everybody's a winner.
And that's
oh my god!
How you play?
I can think of no better way to go out on that one.
So if you have suggestions for other sorts of fails or something similar, we can do the Reddit would be a good place to put those, or if in the Discord, send me a message on the Discord.
Do you want to move on to parkour fails?
That was might involve broken bones.
That's bodily injury.
I feel bad about that because it's like there's no way I'm ever gonna be like physically fit enough to parkour.
So you feel like that's a healthy kid's game to mock parkourers.
Yeah.
Not old.
Are there like backyard wrestling fails?
Middle-aged people. What's that?
Backyard wrestling fails?
Oh, dude. No. People. BMX. Get decapitated on that shit.
Ew.
I don't know.
We need something that's
Pentimenti just says, do gun fails. Gun fails are hysterical.
What about the cinnamon challenge?
We just can't go back to the dark days. There was the period in which, for whatever reason, we went from like comedy sketches at the beginning of the show to like literal faces of death. Like we went through a very emo period about a year and a half ago.
Aphex has it.
That
Russian,
we just can't return to.
Russian dash cam videos.
Oh,
that sounds like faces of death again.
No, but there are those
amazing ones where like a guy gets hit by the motorcycle and they like was that debunked?
Yeah.
There's also animals.
A guy gets hit by a motorcycle, but he flips up onto the top of the car. You guys see that thing? That was like
yeah. Somebody said. Like, is that even JC real? Calhoun says, "What about drone catching fails?"
we didn't. Wait, have hold that on, one wait. On
somebody said boat ramp fails.
Oh my god. Where it's like their car slides down.
cars crossing flood fails.
Oh, flood crossing fails. Yeah. Whether or not they
that's
make it
Texas,
across.
That's a big Texas one. Yeah.
That's pretty good.
It just ends up with us playing Oregon Trail and fording rivers like this.
All right, hold on. Wait a minute. All right, how about this? It is. Let's try boat launch fails.
Okay, I like boat launch.
Let's get boat a lot of different fail. Types. Let's make a. We'll have a thread in the Reddit. We'll have a bunch of different tries. Maybe we'll audition a bunch.
Let's get a nice sampler platter. But I like boat launch. I like for a lot of different reasons. Number one, we're ultimately making fun of rich people, which nobody can blame us for. Yeah. Number two, unlikely that people are going to be dying.
Merman 1983 suggests 11-foot 8-inch bridge fails.
Oh yes, that's
Penny loves those.
Gets a Go is almost one of those. In Boston. And in rush hour traffic, and we pull up and we look at the bridge and we're like literally we had to get everybody out. We had to back up all like 20 or 30 cars of traffic to back out. Like it was ridiculous. Like apparently in Boston there are lots of low bridges and no one told us. And so it was a nightmare. It was a nightmare. Like,
wow.
So yeah, those are ridiculous.
Oh man. So Penny, they watched one of those in her class, and she goes, my favorite was the one where they just decided to go really slow. Like, it would make a difference. And it was just like, the whole way.
Peeling off the top of it.
I hear that sound, but are we making it?
Yeah. No, they just kept going.
All right, I think this is our window to bio break it and refill the cartridge.
All right, well, later. Let's also bring on my lovely wife.
Oh! It's ladies' night.
It's ladies' night.
There we go.
That's ladies' night.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I was putting... aren't you going to pee? I thought you were going to pee.
Yeah, but now I want to know what Hey Now You're a Dog Star is.
Okay. Well...
Check.
We hear you.
Here, yeah. Get...
Go pee.
We can't play...
Check your phone.
Yeah, bio break it is. Also,
I should get a drink.
Hi, Bonnie. You doing good?
Hi, I am doing good. Is this the right volume?
Yeah, you're good.
I'm not really sure. Toasting.
Curtis the Rock says, how's it going, Hank? I don't know what you're talking about. Ashley's yet to come on the stream. So as soon as Ashley comes on the stream, you can talk to Hank all you want.
Oh.
My feeling is it is probably good for her to come by.
No. I know. I know. This is like a bit. We're crossing over bits.
Crossing over.
Oh, Whiskers, you scamp yep. you.
That's it. My childhood nickname that everybody knows, Whiskers.
Everyone knows it.
Whiskers.
Whiskers. Yeah.
Yeah. See, Bonnie, I got this childhood nickname. It's called Whiskers. I got it because I was curious like a cat.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh my god. Oh, we can't hear Ashley. We gotta change that.
Oh. Nope. Nope.
Wait, what do you mean? You can't hear?
She cannot be heard.
It's coming in online, though. Is it on the...
Dude.
Oh. Turn your girl up.
Is it turned off? Because that was the problem before. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
Hey, there she is. That's it.
Hey!
Hello.
Point being, it's not true. He's full of shit. He's gaslighting me. That's all. I'm going to go get.
Number one, this vacation, it's just a long-standing thing that everybody knows.
Not true.
That as a young child.
Your childhood nickname was Hank. F off.
As a young child, I was given the nickname Whiskers.
Your Whiskers. Yeah. I remember when I knew you when you were a child.
Exactly. Bryce has known forever that my childhood nickname is indeed Whiskers.
So we're going to play, I think it's called I Said What?
Who said I Said that? What?
I Said What?
Except,
but with different players.
This time it's going to be the ladies are spouses.
Yay.
They're going to see which of their husbands said the likely offensive, horrifying things that we have said in the years we've done this show.
There's some really good ones in here, too.
Oh, my gosh.
There's some pretty good ones in here.
You know what's really funny, Ashley, is whenever I see scarves and short sleeves, I always think, oh, do you have a hickey? So, Ashley.
Oh, shit.
You guys been smooching on your birthday?
Wait a minute. Now I'm asking. Wait, what the fuck?
Yeah.
Do you have a hickey? Tell me it's scarf, bitch.
Whoa. She did not like that.
No, nor should she. That's disrespectful.
It's mean.
Not very nice. It's Valentine's Day.
It is. I should be nice.
It's a love day. It's about love. Love, guys. Hi, Internet. How are you? I missed you. It's been a long time. Do you have feedback from, when I'm here?
Might have a little bit, but we can turn down.
Do you guys hear feedback?
No, we hear you pretty good.
Good.
By the way, right now there are only 2 entries in Diamond Time today.
Is your birthday today or is it yesterday?
It was yesterday. Yeah.
I thought it was the actually Valentine's for some reason.
Happy birthday!
Well, happy birthday. Hope it was fun.
Thank you.
Did y'all go and celebrate?
We did. We went to one of our favorite restaurants, Millennium, out in Oakland, which is one of the best vegan restaurants in the world. And we wound up spending too much money, but that's what we like to do.
More like millennial.
It was
also
true
because Justin is a millennial.
All of the people in the restaurant kept asking us what's a Ninja Turtle and.
Oh my gosh.
Now, such a millennial in denial.
See, I don't know. Ashley, you can't just I can't be 30 and tell me that I'm part of
a
new generation.
You are of the definition of millennial.
That's
by
number one.
It's both.
I grew up being.
See, Brian knows.
Dude, grew up being Gen Y. It was because we are similar to Gen X, but different in that we had the internet. It is a subsection of a larger demographic group. You can't just now that I can't pay down my student debt and then say you're a millennial. That's not a thing.
You are a millennial though.
Yeah, no, look, Gen Y didn't take, and you're certainly not Gen X, because 50-year-olds are Gen X.
Wait, Gen X are 50?
I am on the youngest side of the Gen X. Gen X.
What?
I'm in the
That doesn't sound right.
Dude, look it up. Siri.
Look at Wikipedia.
Alexa, what is a
Gen Xer?
If your face pops up, then we're going to be
out. Blink!
Stryker Rich says 1964 to 1980?
Is Jan X. That's right. Whoa. That's right.
These useless words are making me upset.
That, I'm not thinking about it
anymore. By the way, Gen X is way cooler than the word millennial.
Millennials, also known as Generation Y, are a demographic cohort.
It was invented in like 2012. Like, you can't just like invent a thing so late in the game.
Because they go, why do I need to move out of my house?
Well, yeah, and it's crazy because the thing is that, like, particularly now, you would think that, like, that they would separate them out by, like, every 7 or 8 years as opposed to, like, because every 20 years, because your experience is so different, you know, even in a decade, you know, start at the beginning of the aughts versus the end of the aughts. Like, you know, if you became an adult at that period of time, very different experience anyway. So,
well, I mean, listen, here's the line of demarcation. Do you remember a part of your childhood where the internet wasn't ubiquitous?
Yeah. Amen. Like, amen.
Then you are generation whatever. Whatever you want to call it.
Generation letter.
Then there's millennials. That's the line of demarcation for me.
Amen. I mean, I totally subscribe to your that perspective. There you go.
Yeah, it was over with me and my first boyfriend because I was not impressed with his hard drive. I was like, what? I don't even know which. If he had an Apple and not like, whatever.
There's so
many. She was like, but she knew deep down she wanted to be part of the PC. I can't say these kind of things.
That's right. Say some terrible jokes. Oh, no.
You're more appropriately Generation Butthurt, obviously. So that's all right.
All right. All
right. You said Generation Butthurt.
Keep it above the belt.
Nope.
right.
Yeah. Give me a few more minutes. Something just popped up.
Okay.
And not Bonnie's ex-boyfriend.
And I'm assuming this
is a recording must fix it right now issue.
Got it.
Although I do think that Generation Butthurt might actually be a good like alternative name for the millennial. Yeah, isn't it like the only?
Yeah, for millennials.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
What is it now?
Be a millennial like, because you like making generation? Fun of me.
No, I don't want to be a millennial because then it makes me seem less impressive that I married you.
Okay. Oh, all right.
You're actively rooting for this May December thing.
I'm like, it's way cooler. I'm like, all right, like I can't when after I have gray temples, you can't come back at me and say, yeah, you and the 12-year-old have so much in common. You're the same generation.
Gen preparation age.
Oh my gosh. Isn't generation.
Anyway, hi Mike, nice to see you. How's it going?
Yeah, excellent. How are you? Hey, so I will have more stuff for you in the next couple of days. So I've got some things in the works. So
whenever people love it. People love it all. So yeah.
Ashley's stream now is like basically scored by all Mike TV stuff. Like you have the intro, you got the outro, and they play all the Get Set Go stuff in between.
That's great.
Yeah, because she has spectacular taste in music.
Obviously.
Mm-hmm. All by the way, Merman 1983 says Intellivision better than ColecoVision. Come at me. You're right.
Yeah. You know,
Intellivision was the jam.
Wait, was Intellivision? Were they the ones that had the D&D game?
Yeah.
Oh man. Like you,
where everything was green except for your bubble around you, and you went running. Yeah. No, it was
great. We had Intellivision. My parents always picked the wrong whatever. Like they put. Oh, yeah, they picked a Betamax.
Yeah, it was Betamax.
Buy a Betamax, did they?
Yeah,
the Betamax was great. I mean, it was the we better technology. But
yeah, well, that's
just,
what they
just nothing was offered in it. Yeah, like
exactly. There was like, but you could film porn on VHS, so that one took off. And then they might have changed their mind if they'd known. I don't know. I had never asked. No, probably not.
All right, fire is put out. Thank you, guys.
Cool.
We're ready Roger to start that.
And then we had Intellivision. Oh. And then, of course.
You had Intellivision?
We had Intellivision.
Crazy.
Yeah, I played. It was like you had to jump over logs and snakes. And
oh, Pitfall. Pitfall, yeah.
That was not on Intellivision.
That was on Atari.
Wait.
No, it was. They made a version for
television.
That's pretty. But dope. we had the Atari 2600 like after the 5200 came out. I'm like, oh great, yeah, this is awesome. And then I had all the little like kind of like LED games though, you know. And
LED. Yeah, the LED. Yeah, like the football with dots.
Yeah, that shit was the jam.
Yeah.
And the one with the guy. The guy that was like people would jump out of a building and you were like a firefighter trying to you bounce them all the way to the other end. And I would line them up and be like, I've got my own arcade. I had like six of them. This is my arcade, man. Hell yeah.
Started charging a quarter.
Yeah, my sisters, I did. A nickel.
I remember as a kid, one of the first times I heard cursing, there was a video game called Crazy Climber, where ostensibly your job was to stop society as you climbed up the side of a building, and then some, you know, tenants would do crazy things like open their window.
Throw pots
out, because that's something that happens in the city all the time, right? And then when you got knocked on the noggin, you would fall down and die, and you'd go, oh no! And it'd go do 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 do. But that was one of the first times I remember. The guy getting hit in the head, and I'm six, and he goes, oh no! And the guy goes, fuck you! And like, I thought that was a
what?
Like, that seemed rude.
Who said that?
Like, and then I became an adult. Well, I don't know, some teenager. I don't know.
Making fun of the game was like
right, exactly. But it's like that was a profound moment.
I thought it was one of those like I thought you were gonna try to pull one of those schoolyard like, oh, you know, if you hit like. Up, down, down. Like, he screams, fuck you, instead of, oh, no, right?
I wonder if anybody on their own discovered, like, their dad's Custer's Revenge cartridge.
Oh, Jesus.
I don't even know what that is.
Oh, you guys don't know what Custer's Revenge is?
No. What's Custer's Revenge?
Yeah, no, I literally just said, oh, Jesus, to fit in. But if nobody else knows, then I'm going to go ahead and
Is it a dirty
Atari game?
It is literally an Atari 2600 game about the non-consensual rape of Native Americans. And it's called Custer's Revenge. And the art, a real thing.
Would this happen in the 70s?
Like 79, 80. Yeah, it was a real game. And I'm seeing skeptic eyes.
I don't doubt it. I don't doubt it.
That's awful.
I mean,
I heard they were playing it at Standing Rock.
What
the fuck?
Oh my god. Fucking Jim Jeffries over here.
Custer's Revenge was an adult video game produced in 1982 by Mystique for Atari.
You were Custer. There was a tied up Native American woman. You had to dodge the arrows so you could rape her with your giant boner, which was graphically depicted on the Atari 2600.
Oh my god, that is ridiculous. My dad didn't play any games. Like, dig games.
Oh, so you're defensive? Dad showed me a different game.
Okay, wait a minute. All right. If you found your father's Custer's Revenge, what would you be most offended by, the rape or the racism?
I mean, I would not have a context for either, right? I would...
like, well, because I know my father is both a racist and a rapist.
No. I mean, it's so weird to think that there was a time when neither of those words meant much to society, much less 6-year-old Brian.
Well, enough that
somebody's
able to walk into an office and be like, all right, I got a pitch.
I know. That's the part that blows my mind. Like, at some point, this shit got approved, written, art was submitted. Somebody made a correction. We're like, well,
BioCow's got a JPEG down there. Let's take a look at this boner.
And I know that they thought. Okay. It's Atari.
All right. Oh my gosh. Yep.
Hey, who wants to do a show?
Hey, this is the Halloween episode, right? Or not Halloween episode, Valentine's Day episode.
Hey,
right?
Happy Valentine's Day, everybody! I agree. Let's start the show.
Balloon nuts. The '80s were kind of
all right.